لقد كان لكم في رسول الله أسوة حسنة لمن كان يرجو الله لمن كان يرجو الله واليوم الآخر وذكر الله كثيرا.
الحمد لله الحمد لله على حلمه بعد علمه وعلى عفوه بعد قدرته والصلاة والسلام على سيد الأنبياء والمرسلين وعلى آله وأصحابه وسلم تسليما كثيرا كثيرا. أما بعد، فأعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم، بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. فرح المخلفون بمقعدهم خلاف رسول الله وكرهوا أن يجاهدوا بأموالهم وأنفسهم في سبيل الله وقالوا لا تنفروا في الحر، قل نار جهنم أشد حرا لو كانوا يفقهون. صدق الله العظيم. Respected viewers, we welcome you back once again to the program The Perfect Example, where we study the life of our beloved Nabi Kareem sallallahu alaihi wasallam and various incidents that transpired during the life of our Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. In our last program, we had spoken about beyond the expedition, beyond the wars, beyond the various other interaction. One interaction that Nabi Kareem sallallahu alaihi wasallam had with people was on a one-to-one basis. And how Nabi Kareem sallallahu alaihi wasallam was able to win over the hearts of prominent individuals with his akhlaq and his conduct. People just bowed down in submission to the noble character of our beloved Nabi Kareem sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And that was a specific program just to speak and look at one or two examples in that regard. So we do not come to the conclusion that the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam's life was only one of going out in expeditions, which was a necessary part of the life because of the enmity, hostility and circumstances surrounding the life of our beloved Nabi Kareem sallallahu alaihi wasallam. After that, we go back again to one of such an expedition. In fact, the last expedition that Nabi Kareem sallallahu alaihi wasallam undertook during his lifetime. And the circumstances behind it were this. The conquest of Makkah had opened up the entire Arabian Peninsula to the Muslim army and to our beloved Nabi Kareem sallallahu alaihi wasallam as the leader. And the unruly Arab tribes had united under the leadership, the greatness, and acknowledging the leadership of Nabi Kareem sallallahu alaihi wasallam. This was to cause consternation and cause the enemies to tremble. And they started looking at the Muslims and the Arabian Peninsula with a new awe. Previous to this, the two superpowers of the time, the Byzantine Empire, which was known also the Roman Empire and the Persian Empire, never worried much about the Arabian Peninsula, saying that the unruly tribes will sort themselves out and they will never ever pose a threat to us. But Nabi Kareem sallallahu alaihi wasallam had united Arabia and had united the Arabian Peninsula under the kalima la ilaha illallah Muhammadur Rasulullah, and they were forced to take notice. The Battle of Muta, although it did not end decisively for the Muslims, but the fact that 3,000 Muslims could hold their own against overwhelming odds, over 100,000 people against 100,000 people, 3,000 holding their own, brought about a new respect for Islam and Muslims and the leadership of Nabi Kareem sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And they realized that they needed to do something. And the Byzantine Empire, which was a superpower of the time, the headquarters of the Eastern Empire of the Roman Empire, the eastern part of the Roman Empire, the western part, the capital was Rome, the eastern part was Constantinople, nowadays known as Istanbul, and they the frontiers between the Arabian Peninsula and the eastern capital of the Roman Empire, Istanbul, was Syria. And many of the tribes around the Syrian side of the Arabian Peninsula, where down in Syria is presently, were Christian tribes. So the Byzantine Empire had sent a great force and had gotten together with some of the Christian tribes on the Arabian-Syrian Peninsula, the border between Arabia and Syria, and they had prepared an army. The tribes residing in the border area, like the tribe of Lakham, Amila, Ghassan, and Jazam, Ghassan was the most famous of those tribes, joined them in the army and they proceeded up to Balqa, which was just outside the Arabian Peninsula. Nabi Karim sallallahu alayhi wa sallam came to know about this by the traders who used to come to Medina from Syria and used to come sell the olive oil, which was famous in Syria. And they used to come to Medina and they used to sell those olive oil. And that this army has been prepared by this Byzantine Empire to come and attack the Muslim. So Nabi Karim sallallahu alayhi wa sallam had few options how to deal with this new threat. Arabian Peninsula, by and large, all the different tribes that come under the leadership. Here was a threat from beyond the peninsula, from an international entity, so to speak. And the Byzantine Empire was at that time the superpower of the time. What was one of the most, if not the most, powerful civilizations and army and power and authority of the time, only matched by the Persian Empire, which it had also defeated. So by and large, it was the most prominent power and authority of the time. And it set out its forces to attack the Muslims or to come towards Medina and to take action against the growing strength of the Muslim. Nabi Karim sallallahu, when he heard about this from the traders of Syria, had few options. One of the options, Nabi Karim sallallahu could have allowed them to proceed, but in that there could have been greater danger to Islam and the Muslims. But Nabi Karim sallallahu chose the most decisive and the most brave of all the options. And Nabi Karim sallallahu alayhi wa sallam decided to march against this army. This was a tremendous act of inspiration and leadership. A tremendous act of bravery. Bear in mind that given the reputation of the Byzantine Empire as a superpower of the time, the Arabs held the Byzantine Empire and the Byzantines in awe. They could not even dream of even confronting them, never mind marching out against them. But Nabi Karim sallallahu alaihi wasallam was having the faith in Almighty Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Nabi Karim sallallahu alaihi wasallam was guided by faith in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And Nabi Karim sallallahu alaihi wasallam chose this option. And Nabi Karim sallallahu alaihi wasallam told the Sahaba to get ready to face the Byzantine Empire. This was a tremendous act of bravery and inspiration and leadership. Because they had set out, and if Nabi Karim sallallahu alaihi wasallam had allowed them to come into the Arabian Peninsula, then to confront them would have been even more difficult. So Nabi Karim sallallahu alaihi wasallam, to take the initiative, Nabi Karim sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, we will march. But there were various different type of situations that faced the Muslims. One was the awe in which the Byzantine Empire, by and large, was held by the Arab people. And Nabi Karim sallallahu alaihi wasallam had to contend with an inferiority type of complex that was built prior to the coming of Islam. Obviously, with the coming of Islam, Muslims were now guided by a greater principle. The greatness and the power of Almighty Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala superseded all superpowers. However, this was a practical reality Nabi Karim sallallahu alaihi wasallam had to deal with. Coupled with that, at that time in the history of Medina, the Muslims had more or less the last couple of years before that had suffered some sort of drought and famine. They were not good crops. Medina depended upon the date crops. And for several years prior to leading this expedition, there was not a very good yield of the crops. And it was in the heat of Arabia, in the midst of summer. And how Allah Ta'ala tests people, that after several lean years with regard to the crops, this year promised, or at least there was a prospect of a bumper crop. and everything was in that direction, that there is going to be a bumper crop after several lean years. That was one of the aspects. The other aspect, it was in the midst and in the middle of summer. Then together with that, you had to undertake a very far journey. At that time, it was the longest of all the journeys that Nabi Karim Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam had undertook during his life in any one of the expedition. It was over 1,000 kilometers, and bear in mind that time there was no mechanical type of or other types of conveyance. The conveyance was either through the means of camel or through the means of the horseback, and to travel over 1,000 kilometers. Then coupled with the fact that Muslims were very lacking in resources at that time, given the fact that they had already spent 2 or 3 years prior to that, did not have a very good crop. So all of these coupled made this expedition a very trying one, a one of full of trials, and one of examination for the determination, the courage, and the iman of the Muslims. And we will continue with this after the break. Respected viewers, welcome back once again to our program. Prior to the break, we were speaking about the circumstances behind the expedition of Tabuk. We had said that the Byzantine Empire had sent an army and had got the Christian tribes around the Syrian border ready to fight against the Muslims. Nabi Karim Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam came to know about it. Given the strength and the awe of the Byzantine Empire, Nabi Karim Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam had few options, and he chose the most brave of those options, that he will march against them. And how difficult it was. It was difficult because of the famine that had come upon Medina for the past few years prior to this expedition, the long journey over 1,000 kilometers on horseback or on camelback, the lack of resources in the midst of summer, all of that coupled made this a very trying expedition. Nabi Karim Sallam first specified the destination, told people, we are going to the Syrian border. This was against the normal pattern of Nabi Karim Sallam, that Nabi Sallam sometimes used to leave Medina and go in one direction, and after a few days he used to change the direction so as to catch the enemy by surprise and to come at where the enemies were in such a way that they did not know the Muslims are coming. But here, because of the long journey, Nabi Karim Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam did not leave anything in vague. Nabi Karim Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam determined, we are going to the Syrian border. So everyone knew the odds. Coupled with that, they knew that it was in the midst of the summer. They also knew that they were expecting a bumper crop after several lean years. So it was a trying time. And Nabi Karim Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, because of the lack of resources, asked people to contribute. And may we be sacrificed upon the Sahaba's jazba. And may we be sacrificed upon how the Sahaba looked upon this as an opportunity to come closer towards Almighty Allah. The very famous incident of Abu Bakr and Umar took part at this expedition, when Nabi Karim Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam called people to be generous and to be able to contribute to the army and for the sake of this expedition. People were in the forefront. Umar radiallahu anhu said, I said that this is the time when I'm going to supersede and overtake Abu Bakr. Every time I tried to compete with him, he was always ahead of me. Today, because I had had wealth that had come my way in transactions, I thought I'm going to be able to overcome Abu Bakr. So I went confidently with whatever I had, and I went to Nabi Karim Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, and Nabi Karim Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam said, and he said, the way Nabi Karim Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam asked me the first question. The first question Nabi Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam said, when he asked me, I already felt that I'm going to lose the battle. Here they were competing not for egos, but for the sake of good, which Allah Ta'ala says, فَاسْتَبِقُوا الْخَيْرَاتِ. Compete with one another in goodness. If you have to compete, don't compete with one another in egos. Don't compete with one another in cars and musical systems. Compete with one another in good deeds. So this was what the Sahaba and Umar radiallahu anhu was after. So he said, when Nabi Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam asked me the first question, I knew I'm going to fail. I'm not going to be able to compete. He asked, oh Umar, how much did you leave behind? Normally, if anyone comes with any contribution, the first question you ask him is, how much have you brought? Let me cut a receipt for how much you have given to the good cause. And when Nabi Karim Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam asked Umar, he said, how much did you leave behind? And Umar radiallahu anhu said, I left half behind. 50% of his wealth he gave in this expedition. Today, who gives 50% of their wealth? We give 2.5%, and that also with great difficulty, and we feel that we have done the entire ummah and we have done Islam a favor. And he said, how much I have brought, that much I have left. And Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu came, and Nabi Karim sallallahu alaihi wasallam asked Abu Bakr, "Oh Abu Bakr, what have you left behind for your family?" And Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu said, "I have left Allah and His Rasul for my family. I have brought all my goods to be given in this expedition." Such was the jazbah, such was the enthusiasm, such was the sacrifice, such was the love to contribute for the sake of good. And amongst them, there were many other people who gave. Abdurrahman ibn Auf gave 200 ounces of silver. Umar radiallahu anhu, as we said, paid half his fortune. Hazrat Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu left Allah and His Rasul behind for his family. Abbas gifted a lot of money. Talha, Sa'd bin Ubadah, and Muhammad ibn Maslama contributed greatly. Asim bin Adi, on his turn, offered 90 camel burdens of dates to be able to use in this expedition. Even the woman gave their jewelry to come part, and one of them gave whatever he had in terms of wheat. He gave it in front of Nabi Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam. "Ya Rasulullah, this is my contribution." But the greatest contribution in terms of quantity came from Usman radiallahu ta'ala anhu. Nabi Karim Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam got up and asked, "Oh people, we are short of resources. Come and contribute." Uthman radiallahu anhu got up. "Ya Rasulullah, 100 camel laden with all its goods and its supplies from my side." Nabi Karim Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam praises him. Nabi Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam prays for him. And Nabi Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam said, "Is there anyone who will give?" He got up. "Ya Rasulullah, another 100 camels." And then again he got up until mention is made that he gave 940 camels and 100 horses, besides giving so many gold coins. And when he came and gave his gold coins to Nabi Karim Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, Nabi Karim Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam was crying, and the Sahaba said, Nabi Karim Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam was taking the money and the dinars that Usman radiallahu ta'anhu gave, and he was, you know, taking it through his fingers and said, "Ma dharra Uthman ma amila ba'd al-yawm." Nothing will harm Usman after this, whatever he does. It doesn't mean that he was given a license to do whatever it was wrong, but this was his sacrifice. If a person can sacrifice so much for a cause, then surely he is sincere, he is dedicated, he is loyal. He's not going to do anything against that cause thereafter. And Nabi Karim sallallahu alaihi wasallam was so happy with Uthman radiallahu ta'ala anhu. But despite this, despite that, despite all of this, it was a very trying circumstances, because of all these resources put together, there were 30,000 people, and they had to travel for over a month, and they had to travel for such a vast distance, and there were still not enough resources. In fact, at times, they were 18 people on one camel. They could not even have much food, so sometimes they used to take the leaves of the tree, and they used to break up the leaves, and they used to chew that to satisfy the pangs of hunger. Sometimes they used to slaughter the camels which they used to depend upon. Camels was one of the mainstay of the life in the Arabian Peninsula, and they used to slaughter it, not so much for the meat, but for the water that was in the stomach of the camel. This was the difficulty, and that is why this is known as the expedition of distress. But the Sahaba did not back down. They did not back down. In fact, some of them, the way Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in Surah Bara'ah, وَلَا عَلَى الَّذِينَ إِذَا مَا أَتَوْكَ لِتَحْمِلَهُمْ قُلْتَ لَا أَجِدُ مَا أَحْمِلُكُمْ عَلَيْهِ تَوَلَّوْا وَأَعْيُنُهُمْ تَفِيضُ مِنَ الدَّمِ حَزَنًا أَلَّا يَجِدُوا مَا يُنْفِقُونَ. A group of seven Ansari came to Nabi Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam. "Ya Rasulullah, we want to take part in this battle. We would love to take part. We don't have resources. Can you make resources available to us? Give us one camel. We will be able to do so, and we will be able to join this battle." Nabi Karim Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam looked around, and whatever had been allotted, there was no further camels to allot. And Nabi Karim Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam excused himself. And Allah Ta'ala says, "Tawallaw wa'ayunuhum tafidu minad dam'i hazanan." They went away from the gathering of Nabi Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam with tears in their eyes, that they could not be able to participate in this expedition because of resources. Two amongst them, Abdurrahman ibn Mughaffal and another Sahabi, Abdurrahman ibn Kab, they managed to get hold of another person by the name of Yamin ibn Umair. And he said, "I will make a camel available to you." And they joined the expedition. So on this time, this was the way Nabi Karim Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam got this army ready. And in this particular way, there were 30,000 people who got ready to take part in this expedition, that before the Byzantine comes to come and harm us, we are going to march against them to show them that we are not frightened, we are not weak. Do not dare lift a finger against the growing strength of Islam and the Muslims. We will deal with you on an equal footing, not because you are the Byzantine Empire and the Roman Empire that we are going to shield or back away. And then, of course, we had the amazing aspect of the hypocrites who looked at all different excuses of not taking part. And they looked at all of these excuses, and part of their excuses were different type of excuses. Sometimes were such were even in the absurd. Some of them went to go and tell them or the Muslims that Nabi Karim Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam had made an error in judgment. He is not fighting against one of the Arab tribes. He is fighting against the Byzantine Empire. He is fighting against the superpower of the time. He would not be able to bear their power and their strength. And then when they could not change the morale of the Muslims who still continued, then they said, are you going to go into this burning sun of the Arabian Peninsula in the heat of the summer? And they said, لا تنفروا في الحر, don't go out into the summer heat. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala replied to them and said, قُلْ نَارُ جَهَنَّمَ أَشَدُّ حَرَّ, don't you know that the fire of Jahannam is even more intense in heat? Then one of them was by the time of Al-Ja'ad bin Qais. Al-Ja'ad bin Qais came and he said that I cannot go. Don't you know I'm infatuated by women? And if I'm going to go and face the Roman Empire, they have women who are fair skinned. I would not be able to control myself. Rather, I will not take part in the battle. So they found every excuse not to come. And of course, the journey was such a great journey. It was such great amount of sacrifice. It was too great for the hypocrites to even contemplate going. But on the other hand, we had already seen the example of the Sahaba and the faithful. Despite the difficulty, they stood firm and they were steadfast of taking part in this expedition upon the call of Nabi Karim sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And in our next program, we will continue with this, how this expedition turned out. It turned out even better than anticipated because of the iman, the steadfastness of the Sahaba and the leadership and the inspiration of our beloved Nabi Karim sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And may we always be inspired by his greatness and his example. Wa akhiru da'wana alhamdulillahi rabbil alamin.
لقد كان لكم في رسول الله أسوة حسنة لمن كان يرجو الله واليوم الآخر وذكر الله كثيرا.